talk about what Paul was expressing here, Paul says that I may know him. And the question becomes with the Apostle Paul, well, didn't he know the Lord? Don't you know the Lord, Apostle? Yes, the Apostle knew him, but the expression here is I want to know him more. And see, the way that you describe the Lord, it relates to your relationship under his lordship. It relates to how you receive Jesus Christ as Lord. I just want us to back up just a little bit, and we're not going to read the entire chapter 3, but I want you to see where Paul says, now listen, here is in verse 5, Paul says, circumcised the eighth day. Do you see that? He was circumcised the eighth day. That's the day you're supposed to have been circumcised, he says. Of the stock of Israel. Now listen, of the tribe of Benjamin. Now many in the children of Israel, they did not know what tribe they were from. Paul knew what tribe he was from the tribe of Benjamin. Listen, a Hebrew of the Hebrews. As touching the law, he was a Pharisee. In other words, he was, as we would say today, he was such a philosopher in the law of God. But then he goes down and he says this in verse 6, concerning zeal persecuting the church, because they were against God's church. And he says he was persecuting the church before he got saved, touching the righteousness which is in the law blameless. Here it is right here now. I want you to get this. He says, but what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. What was gained to me, he says, they are nothing. And what Paul started off in chapter 3 teaching, in essence, he was saying, if you're boasting on who you are, boasting on what you have, boasting on what you do, Paul said, then let me boast in the flesh. Let me tell you, and Paul was on the top shelf of everything. And yet Paul says, but I count it as dung, meaning it's nothing. It's nothing compared to Jesus Christ. I count it as what? Dung. And you know what dung is. I'll leave it there. He says, but what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. Yes, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, and for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. When we boast upon ourselves, we never win Christ. And to win Christ is to simply say that Christ is winning life for you. You can't win without Jesus Christ. And Paul says that I may win Christ. That's what he wants, and that's what we want. We want Jesus. Because when you have Jesus, hallelujah, he adds everything to your life. When you have Jesus, everything is, if you would, it's locked up in Jesus. And Paul says that I may win Christ. And then he says, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. And see, that is so essential, because in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, it says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that come to God must believe that God is, and that God is a rewarder of them that diligently, listen, seek him. That is going after Jesus Christ. God is wanting us to know what pleases God is faith. And when we're not in faith, that is trusting in God, when we don't have F-A-I-T-H, forward action in trusting him. And so many people, they can hear the word of God and yet and still they do not obey God. And what that says is that you don't have faith in God, Because if you hear his word and don't obey his word, why wouldn't you obey his word? Because you don't trust in God. You don't have faith in God. And faith is the key to everything in the Christian's life. It's all about him. It's all about seeking him. It's all about acknowledging him. It's all about hearing what he says and obeying what he says. Now, we're talking tonight about, Lord, I want to know you more. It's not just enough to say, well, I know the man upstairs. No, you don't know the Lord. The man upstairs, it ain't no upstairs. Hello. Are you talking about the third floor, the fourth floor? Are you talking about the projects? What are you talking about? Because the one we're talking about, he's in glory. He's in heaven. Hallelujah. He's not the man upstairs. He's the Almighty God. The name Elohim, E-L-O-H-I-M. Elo. Elo is strong and mighty God. He's the strong and mighty God. He is the strong and mighty God. That's L, E-L. Can you say that? The strong and mighty God. He's what? The strong and mighty God of creation and restoration. He's the one that created everything, and whatever the devil will steal from you, God can restore it back to you. He's the God of creation and restoration. Yeah, don't give him a patty cake. Go ahead. Everyone bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Bless him. He's Elohim, the God of creation and restoration. He's Elohim, the strong and mighty God, listen to this, of beginnings and good things. He's the God that creates the beginning, and he's the one that gives us the good things. That's what Elohim means. Elo, it means strong and mighty God. But then I am at the end is the Hebrew for plurality. When we say I am at the end, it's the Hebrew for plurality. Like, for example, you can have a cherub, C-H-E-R-U-B. Cherub means what? An angel. But then when you say cherubim, C-H-E-R-U-B-I-M, that's plurality. It's more than just one angel. Now, what we use in the English language is when we talk about plurality, we use the S or the I-E-S, mother. And in other words, if it's a boy, we say a boy, that's B-O what? Y. But if it's boys, it's B-O-Y-S. More than one boys. We say baby, B-A-B-Y. But if we say babies, it's B-A-B-I-E-S. I-E-S is plurality. So the I am, it stands for plurality. And you're going to see that God is a triune God. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that's why he's called Elohim. Elohim. Now I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Colossians. Let's go there. That's right after Philippians. Where you are, go to the book of Colossians. Here we grow again. And see, we can grow if we know by way of experience God. See, you can learn in school and still have not experienced what you learn. But when you experience what you learn, that's how you grow. The level of our maturity is the level of our ability, number one, to hear from God and then step out and obey what God say. See, some hear from God, but they never step out and obey what God say. Therefore, they never grow. The level of our maturity is the level of our ability to trust in God when things go wrong, when people disappoint you, when you're mystified and you don't know why, but you still trust in the Lord with all of your heart. This is what the Bible says. You don't quit on, never quit on God, because God is not through with the story yet. It's his story, and it turns to be his glory. Watch and see what God does for you. The level of our maturity is the level of our ability. Number three is to yield your will in submission and obedience with humbleness and meekness, to humble ourselves. When we quote the 91st Psalm, Anthony, when we, Minister Anthony, when we quote the 91st Psalm, he that dwell in the what? Secret place of the Most High. What is the secret place? The secret place is the humble place. And so many Christians don't know that's the secret place. Why? Because they have not been there. They have not humbled themselves. It's about pride. It's about me, myself, and I. But when you humble yourself, you're in the secret place. You're in the place where God is covering you. He that dwell in the secret place of the Most High shall abide, live under the shadow of Almighty God. Now, if you're not humble, then you are not under the shadow of Almighty God. And then the fourth level of maturity is to endure hardness. People wonder why this hard thing is happening, why I'm going through this. See, God allow you to go through some things so that you can grow in some things. If you don't go through it, you can't grow to it. God wants you to grow up. So he tells us in the word, endure hardness as a good soldier.
Thank you for watching It's All About Him Ministries with Bishop Nate and Valerie Holcomb. If you'd like to purchase a copy of today's message, please log on to our website at www.chop.org. If you're ever in the area, please join us for any and all of our worship services at 3300 East Anschluter Loop in Killeen. Services are held on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. and Wednesday evenings at 7 p.m.